shots are from Cheap Trick's 1978 tour of Japan that produced their Smash Live LP. Formed in Europe back in 1974, the band toured the club circuit in the Midwestern United States, opened for people like Kiss, Boston, and Kansas on the concert scene, and headlined their first major gig at Budokan in Japan. Cheap Trick were in town recently for a concert, and I asked Rick Nielsen what the Japan tour was like.
Pandemonium. Pandemonium from that word isn't on here, I don't think. So if you need to get a dictionary to find that one. We had no idea what to expect. We heard as we're flying, it's a 14-hour flight from Chicago, and we're on the plane. We were on tour right up until the day we went, and we heard that, one, it would either be completely crazy, or two, they're very reserved, and, well, we found out that it was completely crazy. As soon as we got to the airport, there were fans all over the place, you know, banners and screaming and yelling. We had to have police take us, like, through separate underground channels at the airports and sneak us out through service entrances and stuff like that. And it was like that the whole trip. When we were in the hotels, and they'd cordon off a whole floor and have karate experts at all the doors and stuff like that, just for protection, you know, because the fans were so wild there. I'll go there again. That was fine. I don't know. It was an interesting situation to be in, and but we didn't let that take us over or something like that. You know, here we are. We're just some guys playing in a band, and it's real interesting to have that sort of affection and adulation. But at the same time, you know, we're realistic about it. You know, hey, well.
Unusual things about Cheap Trick is their personality images, almost like they're from different bands. Rick Nielsen, the loony pick flicker, Bunny Carlos, the cigarette-puffing refugee from Harvard Business School, and Tom Peterson and Robin Zander, the schoolgirl's fantasy of what rock stars should look like. While this strange combination of personnel appears to be the perfect marketing vehicle, Rick Nielsen maintains Cheap Trick's only interested in making music.
We got together for music, and that's the reason we are together, you know, because we like to play, and it's a good player, it's a good band, good songs. We like to perform, we like to entertain people. That was it. It wasn't like, hey, boy, this guy looks real good. You know, Robin, yeah, Robin's a good-looking guy, but, you know, listen to his voice. His voice is great. That's the reason he's in the band. I mean, if he was a real toad-looking guy, or he was real horrible and he had a great voice, he'd still be in the band. And people would say today, man, you know, you've got that good-looking bass player and that singer. I mean, he's not the typical singer because he's so ugly, but, man, his voice is wonderful. You know, it's like we defend ourselves against being ourselves. Instead of, I don't want to be a parody myself, but how could I be a parody myself if what I do is what I am? You know?
But is there no
marketing? That's what he is, too, you know?
Is there no marketing around Cheap Trick, the black and white checks, the strange-looking hammer guitar, the different
images?
That's
my idea. I just made up that stuff. I designed my own sweaters. I designed the guitars. You know, how is that? I don't sell them. I don't sell Hamer guitars. You know, I don't sell that junk. We don't sell checkerboard ties. We don't. We don't really do that stuff. People maybe assume we do, but we don't.
I've heard that Cheap Trick will be doing some film work.
Yeah, we've got something in mind.
What's going to make your movie different from the other rock movies we've seen? Gimme Shelter, some the Pink Floyd movie, other things like that.
Well, for one, the characters are different. It's us instead of them. But there's very few movies like us that have musicians in it that have ever really done anything for the musician. Maybe add a little mystique or whatever. Most of them have been detrimental to their careers, I think, and they don't come off any good. And that's something we'll try to avoid. We don't want to put out something that people are just going to say, oh, man. Why did they do that? That's a real joke or whatever. So, I mean, we're very cautious. We've been asked for 2 years to do films. And we've been involved in a lot of stuff for a long time and been turning down the offers. I think that's more important. I think that's that's how we do a lot of things. We turn down probably many more things than we ever do. I was asked to be in People magazine 2 years ago, then a year ago, then 6 months ago, then last week. But I tell them no every time. How is that going to help the career? Is that good? I don't think so, because it's always they try to drag up dirt, or, you know, my line is, you know, they want to come over and see you cooking eggs in the nude or whatever, or taking your garbage out. I think that really has no bearing on what we do.
Are we really the dream police?
There's a song about your subconscious, you know, your yin and yang, your positive negative forces inside your brain, you know, telling you the one side, the angel says, don't do it, Rick, it's not good for you. Devil on the other side, Rick, come on, it can't hurt, you know, this kind of stuff. Or, you know, putting you in there, it polices your dreams at all times, you know, it's always there, the line is...